my mouth and the meditation of our hearts will be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Take a seat. So I wanted to start this morning by talking about something that might make some of us feel a little bit uncomfortable. And that's the prostate. No one was expecting that, were they? You see, there's this thing about the prostate, I understand, is that if you live long enough, and if you're a gentleman, it's going to cause you trouble. So there's the question that is raised, why hasn't it been dealt with, say, by evolution? It's an obvious question, isn't it? And that's because evolution doesn't care that much. You see, it doesn't stop us from doing our basic job, which is having children and being a good dad. It doesn't stop those things from happening nearly often enough for evolution to deal with the problem. It's a cost-efficient way of dealing with things. Which leads me very neatly to the story of Abraham, who, whilst quite elderly, did, in fact, manage to become a father. And in the reading we have today from the Old Testament, we have the story of Abraham starting with a conversation with God, where God says, take your son, go to the region of Moriah, and there make a sacrifice. And it's in the structuring of a test we normally understand of faith. And at that stage, I want to suggest that quite possibly Abraham fails the test of being a good father. That is not something we would do. That is not something I would countenance. So when I come to this passage and I read it, I'm tempted to rip it from my text and discard it. So how has it been interpreted traditionally? How's it been interpreted? In the first instance, of course, it's been interpreted as a test of Abraham's faith. Is Abraham's faith in God so great that Abraham is willing to sacrifice his only legitimate son? His hope for a future, you've got to remember for people back then, your future was determined by your male lineage. That was what counted. Does Abraham trust God so much that he's willing to undertake that? And they go up the mountain, and Abraham's about to sacrifice his son, and God says, just teasing. You don't actually have to do that. Just kidding. Yeah, I don't like that interpretation. I really don't. Some people have taken it as a foreshadowing text. You know how have you watched Jaws? Yeah. Well, does this make it ring a bell? Right. Okay. So that's a musical foreshadowing of something that's about to go wrong. This is a text. Some people have interpreted this as a textual foreshadowing of God's willingness to sacrifice God's own son. And that only makes sense if you interpret the death of Jesus as being God's malicious desire to kill someone for sinning, who didn't sin. That's a problem. I mean, because you've got to assume that God likes killing off people, including innocent people, for that to work. And it doesn't. There are much better interpretations of that text about God reaching out to us. So for me, I come back, in a sense, to the story of evolution. Why hasn't evolution dealt with the prostate? Because of the function it does, cheaply enough. It's a really important thing to remember. It's got a job to do and it does it, and it doesn't, and it's not such an expensive job that it means the rest of the body collapses before we've had a chance to do our job as human beings. And scripture is chosen quite often. It's remembered and passed. You've got to remember, this comes from a time before they had writing like we do. So they told the story. And then the next generation told the story because they recognized something of God in it. And the next generation told the story because they recognized something of God in it. And because it was useful. What did this reading do? What was its use? What changed after Abraham came down the mountain with his son? What never, ever happened again in God's people? It's a really important question. Because it tells us something of the trajectory that God wishes us to take. Before this moment, it was not an uncommon thing for people to be asked to sacrifice their own children. There were religious traditions around which it was, I'm not going to say common practice, but not uncommon. And after Abraham comes down the mountain, never again have one of God's people sacrificed the life of another for God. Because they understood that that is not what God wants of us. You can't tame God by sacrificing someone else. It doesn't work that way. This passage, this strange, odd story about someone who's willing to sacrifice their own son, which might horrify us in modern circumstances, is that last moment. Never again should we be thinking of sacrificing others for our faith. Which leads to a slightly more confronting moment for us today. If we shouldn't be sacrificing others for our faith, what's the trajectory that God wishes us to take now? This was a big moment. It's okay to end the life of someone else for your faith, so it's not. Where are we now? Surely the trajectory is to continue to be life-giving rather than life-taking. That's the challenge before us as people of faith, to be people who in our actions not only don't sacrifice, that's a minimum standard, if you will, that's a bare minimum. What's the gold standard? What's the best? That in fact we act to give life, to protect life. That is what we are called to do today. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.